Welcome to wine.com experiences. I'm Gwendolyn Osborne. Today we are talking to the legendary winemaker and producer Christian Moex, and we will be tasting both the Napanook and Dominus from his California property, Dominus Estate. Thank you so much to those of you who submitted questions during registration. We are going to be incorporating those through our conversation, so hopefully we'll get all of those answered. If you purchased either of the wines from wine.com, the Napanook or Dominus, please go ahead and get those open. Definitely get them into some glassware. You know, you might also not have these exact wines because we're officially tasting the Napanook 2016 and 2017 and then the Dominus 2017, but perhaps you have an older vintage of either Napanook or Dominus or a few that you have opened, but please go ahead and get your glassware ready. Decanters are even better if you have one, especially for those younger vintages, but I just want everybody to be prepared when we start going into those tasting notes with Christian. And so without further ado, let us welcome the one and the only Christian Moex. Bonjour, Christian. I see you are very safe.
Good afternoon, Gwendolyn. A pleasure to be with you.
Thank you so much for taking the time to talk and share these wines. Before we get started with the wines, I wanted to touch briefly on your background. You were born into a wine family on the right bank of Bordeaux in Libourne, and your father, Jean-Pierre, was a well-respected merchant and producer. So did you always know growing up that you would be going into the wine industry?
Oh, yes. My father, Jean-Pierre Moex, was a visionary, a real visionary, which means he was foreseeing what would happen 20 years later, whether it was in the wine business or in art as well, modern art. So he was a very authoritative man, which means that I always felt I had little choice to follow his steps, to try to follow his steps, which I have done. And there was never any choice for me, I would say. And besides, I love so much that what I do that I don't think I could have done well anything else. So which means I began to study in the small town of Libourne, where I was born. Then I studied in Bordeaux to prepare what we call in France the grandes écoles. And I got my engineer diploma in agriculture in Paris. I was still a little too young, so to join the family business, I mean. That's when I decided to go to California, and I went to UC Davis, where I had the best time in 68 and 69.
California in those years, lots of fun.
I was not a very serious student at Davis, I must say honestly, but I became friends with many growers, including Bob Mondavi. I was protected by André Tchelichev, who was the winemaker at Beaulieu Vineyards, BV at the time. And my main teacher was Ménard Amorin, who was a very interesting teacher. We got along very well. We had some fights because he was very California-minded. And I welcomed him many times in France to discuss the virtues of both sides. So in fact, with the three mentors, that's one of the reasons for which I returned later to California.
So that's when you fell in love with Napa, but you came back to France with your many, you know, your other properties with La Fleur Petrus and many properties in your family. But in 1982 is when you found the opportunity.
In 1970, my father told me enough fun in California, please come back to manage the family vineyards. And that's when he put me in charge of Petrus, which was kind of surprising for a man. I was only 24 years old. So I managed the family vineyards for many, many years, 38 vintages, in fact, at Petrus. The others I still manage. But, you know, moving from California in the 60s to a town like Libourne, 20,000 people, life was not as fun. And many times in the 70s, I returned to California with the idea to find a good spot to produce wine, of course. Prices in those years were very low. I mean, as little as $20,000 an acre. So it was hard to believe, but it was very approachable. And so I looked in the 70s with the help of Bob Mondavi. I really prospected in 81 and from South California to Mendocino. And I found one or two places which I liked. But the morning I visited Napanook, introduced by Bob Mondavi, who I said was really a mentor for me. I said I was with another winemaker, the young Dan Baron at the time, and I said, this is the place. You know, I got a fantastic feeling on the first day. It was a rainy day. You know, you judge a vineyard much better on a rainy day than on a spring day. On a spring day, it's like young woman, everything is beautiful. On a rainy day, it's a little more difficult, but more significant as well.
That makes sense. So this is where you invested and put your energy for California. So here's the winery that was built in what year?
Yeah, this was built much later. You know, the first vintage of Dominus would have been 82, but we disqualified it because I didn't like the grapes at the last minute. So first was 83. And from 83 to 96, we contract crush at Rombauer. Rombauer was a very generous man. I was so welcome in his winery. It's just 20 miles away. And we produce some good wines in sometimes difficult conditions, you know, because when you contract crush, for instance, you have to queue in line to crush in the morning. But altogether, it went very well. But we were happy to build the winery with the Swiss architects Herzog and de Meuron, who were kind of unknown at the time. They were recommended by my wife, Cherise, who was very much in the art world at that time. And they were very smart because they understood the climate in California is so cool in the winter, sometimes cold, and so hot in the summer with cool nights. So that's why they use those gabions, cages of stone, basalt, coming from American Canyon, very nearby. And they work as a buffer. So they warm it during the day and they cool at night. So this way, we almost don't need temperature control in the winery. They were very, very smart. Sometimes when I see that building 25 years later, I even wonder how I could take a risk of such an architecture. But like many good things, it ages very well. And there is a very good feeling in it, where I hope...
It does look like it could have been built just, you know, two or three years ago.
It's very modern, yes.
Very fantastic. So what was your vision for Dominus? What do you think you brought from France
That would be
California?
To say that I brought something. I was shocked by two things early on. And don't forget that Dominus was a joint venture with the two daughters of John Daniel, and they have been so nice to me, so cooperative, so confident in me. So two things were shocking for me at that time. First, it was the fact that so many vines were irrigated. And with my French approach, I'm in favor of dry farming. You know, for me, philosophically, it's very important. Not to say that it's the first step of a sustainable approach is dry farming, if you think twice. So I wanted to produce a wine which would be from dry farm vines, number one. And number two, a lot of people were still acidifying in those years. Some people may do so, that's their problem. But I wanted to produce a wine without irrigation and without acidification. That was my absolutely precise philosophy. I can tell you, after almost 40 vintages, I have always a dry farm and never acidified.
Wonderful. That is, yes, I know sustainability is something that's important as well, but I wanted to bring back those photos, if we could, of the vineyards, my producer, just because I know you had, we're talking about the planting with the vineyards and how that is different now than it was before.
Yes, well, of course, we planted twice in those 40 years, because first, clearly, it took me some time to understand, we should plant for perfect irrigation, so they are following the slope. Many people said Dominus is on the flat soil. No, it's not on the flat soil. The slope is 4 to 5%. So for me, it's a foothill and it has nothing to do with the flat part of the valley. We replanted following the slope, which is kind of obvious, but it was not the case before. And this way, we are more or less east-west, which means we get much less sunburn. Of course, we had to adapt the trellising, the canopy, which is an a permanent problem, adapting the canopy. We are still working at it after so many years, like many growers in the valley. So that's how we replanted. Of course, we changed the varietals many, many times. Of course, I was my nickname in those years. I produced a Merlot with Cobrant, 1 million Ks at the time. My nickname was Monsieur Merlot. And I thought I should produce a great Merlot in Napa Valley. And it was a complete failure. The Merlot I produced were never good. I know some people produce good Merlot, so they are more talented than I am. But our Merlot were not good. And as we speak today, we don't have a single vine of Merlot, even if the origin was of the
right,
stock was quite good, I can tell you.
So I guess you keep the Merlot in France?
We keep the Merlot in France, even if some people say that with the global warming, it's more difficult to grow good Merlot, which is true. Mm-hmm. So we had to change the canopy in France as well to get more protection from the sun, so that we should not have too much direct impact of the sun on the Merlot berries. Otherwise, we lose the finesse, the possible finesse of the Merlot.
So let's talk a little bit about the wines. We're going to move on to tasting the wines. We're starting with the Napanook. And yeah. Napanook was created after Domus. So the first vintage of Napanook was 1996.
This is right. As long as we were crushing at Trombauer, we didn't have enough tank capacity to produce many wines. So we produced only Dominus at Trombauer. And when we moved to the new winery, then we were able to use some of those grapes, which I had been selling before. The fact of selling grapes, means immediate income. And that was very helpful in the early years, yeah. So that's why the production of Dominus was quite small in the early years. Today, it's not big. A big vintage for us would be 8,000 cases, which for 120 acres vineyard is pretty low, you see.
Anyway. The Napanook comes from Napanook Vineyard, just like Dominus.
Napanook Vineyard, that beautiful vineyard, which I see as we speak, 120 acres, it's an historic vineyard. Mm-hmm. It's supposed to be the first vineyard planted in 1838 by George Yount, who gave the name to Yountville next door. I had to, as a Frenchman, as a foreigner, to say that I have the first planted vineyard in Napa Valley, but apparently, historically, it is true. But I don't use that as a reference. It's a very beautiful vineyard, which was purchased in 1943, as far as I remember, by John Daniel, who was the owner of Inglenook, and he was the one to name that vineyard Napanook.
Yes. So,
that's why when we decided to have another wine from Dominus, we use the name Napanook, which speaks by itself.
Yes. Yeah, it does fit, and I also love the label for Napanook.
The label like was designed by Sherry. Yeah.
And it was done by your wife.
Yeah, it's the idea of the gabions, those lines. It's an image of our architecture, I would say. We should precise that we are very minimalist in our approach. Mm-hmm. As you can see from the big serra behind me, you see, that's our approach all along the line in viticulture and in winemaking, minimalism.
Well, we have the 16. Some people have the 16 available in their markets, and then some people have the 17. I have the 16, so we're going to start with that.
The 16 together.
Yeah.
Oh, it's very spicy on the nose, slightly unusual.
Mm-hmm.
I need to speak to her, please. Oh, well, I can swallow. I can swallow. Okay. After.
No. Join us, Christian. Join us.
No, no, you're right. No, no, Peter, that's a mistake. So the one is rather generous, I find. It's round. I must say, I don't drink it that often. And when I prepared, when I tested it, I was a little struck by the spiciness and the roundness, which is a little unusual for us, because most our wines have a big dominance of Cabernet Sauvignon, clearly. And this one I had to check, and I'll tell you, because normally it's Cabernet Sauvignon 84%, which is lower than usual. Mm-hmm. We are usually around 90. Cabernet Franc 7%, and Petit Verdot 9%. And oh. That's the Petit Verdot, which mm-hmm. usually we keep around 5-6%, which bring that spiciness and that kind of little thickness in that wine, which is not usually what we look for, but it makes the wine more approachable and a little richer, probably, that people like to call it another wine, but in fact, it's a second wine. It comes from younger vines and it is for earlier drinking. Mm-hmm. And that touch of serious touch of Petit Verdot makes it a little more generous than a usual Napanuk, I would describe.
Yes, it's very pretty. Would you describe Napanuk as, I think you just have, but it is more approachable Napanuk, when young?
More approachable, yeah, which means first it is the amount of tannin is slightly lower and sometimes really lower than in Dominus. Still naturally tannic, a good structure, but it's a more friendly wine, more approachable, probably less class as well, but fine, elegant, you see, so that it's a bottle you can open with a normal meal. You don't need a special occasion to open a wine like that. And I think it's kind of reasonably priced as well.
Yes, it certainly is. But what about the 17? So we'll move to the 17 Napanuk.
First, I should say that 16 was a very good vintage over the valley and an easy vintage. What do I call an easy vintage in the valley? That's important to understand. For me, an easy vintage is the right amount of rain during the winter, a nice spring, and a summer, beautiful summer, with some warm, some hot days, but not over 100 degrees Fahrenheit, you see, 38 Celsius. Because then it becomes kind of unbalanced. So that was the case in 16. Good rain, nice spring, beautiful summer, and that's why it's a class, what I call a classic vintage. Mm-hmm. 17 was much more difficult. A lot of rain, probably too much rain in the winter. And usually those very rainy winters, they end with average vintages. I have seen that statistically. Nevertheless, we were expecting to have a very good vintage, not great by any means. But on September 1st, we reach 112. My God. Oh. 112 degrees. How can you? I think we producers in Napa deserve a lot of credit to be able to make good wines and sometimes very good wines with such heat. You know, it's inhuman. 112 on September 1st. So it means that we got a lot of sunburn and we had to be so selective. If we had not been selective, it would have been really an average vintage for us. That's the smallest quantity of Napanuk we ever made, you see. So let's test it together. But how sad to lose a big part of your crop a few days before picking like that.
Yes, yeah, it's very sad.
Yeah, red fruit, very lively. Red fruit, and I will almost say white fruit, which a little floral too. It has a good equilibrium. It's the acidity is slightly higher than our wines usually, very lively. It's quite pleasant. I must say, when we bottled the wine 1 year ago, I was not very fan of it. And it has improved a lot, and same thing for Dominus, which I tested. So it was worth making that very severe selection in 17, even if it is half a quantity for us. But the result is the wines are pleasant. It's not great, but it's a pleasant wine, which I advise you to drink young.
Youngest. Good. That's good to know. So, and we want to talk a little bit about vintages after we taste. So we shall move on to the 2017 Domus.
I am not too descriptive. You may be, maybe some of your friends may be disappointed because, you know, the description when you find those character of pineapple or mango or that, anybody can do that because it's kind of a personal description. So this is why I prefer to be modest first. I don't consider myself as a great taster, but to describe things as an impression rather than analyzing the perfumes and things like that, which probably many people will do better than me.
We will take any of your descriptors or just when to drink and talking about when it shows well and that sort of thing. And, you know, understanding that this is good to be drunk young rather than aging for a long period. So these are all wonderful tips.
You know, I have been asked many times, that's not your question, what is a great wine? There are so many definitions, and I have changed my own definitions with time. Today, my definition, great wine is a wine which travels well. What does that mean? It means because if you drink your Napa wines only in Napa, okay, they show well in Napa, that's good. But you should test them in Sydney, I don't know, in Tokyo, of course, or in Moscow. And then if the wines adapt to different foods, different climate, different atmosphere, then you have a classic wine. You have the possibility of a great wine. You see, it's like people who travel well, who can adapt to any kind of social life. I think they have something else. So that's my definition of the
moment.
That
is one of my favorite definitions for wine. And it makes so much sense. People come, they travel to Italy, they come back and say, this doesn't taste the same when I'm here. It's like, well, you were in a vineyard in Tuscany.
We should not look for excuses, you know, for the wine. The wine is what it is. Sometimes it shows better than others, but it is what it is, you know, yes. Like us. You
know. We are what we are.
Yeah, we are what we are.
So okay, the Domus 2017, so I've decanted mine because it is young.
Yes.
Yes. And so what would you recommend to someone having a younger vintage of Domus? I mean, when is decanting, do you always decant? Do you do that for 2 hours?
The way we age our wines in barrels, let's say, the way we fermented, the way we educate, I really mean educate our wines in barrels, we do it without oxidation, without oxygen, which means that when you open our wines, our bottles, they are always slightly closed. And that's why we need so much decantation. How long a decantation, it depends on the vintage, but at least 1 hour, you know. And then the wines bloom. Some people even sometimes say, oh, my bottle of Dominus, I opened it, I could not finish it, and I finished it the next day or 2 days later, and it was much better. It's true. Sometimes I'm concerned by that. The wines are not supposed to be tested two or 3 days later. So it's a very, very tricky. I would say maybe for a winemaker, it's the most difficult decision. Should we... And I know I discussed it with Michel Roland many, many times. Should the wine show up like that as soon as you open the bottle, or should it be more discreet and develop with air and with time? It's very difficult to have both. Of course, the perfect wine will be great when you open the bottle, perfect a few hours later, and still better 1 day after. It does not exist. I have never found a wine like that. Let's say, ideally, a great vintage should be decanted 2 or 3 hours before. Mm-hmm. That's what I say. But then decantation is difficult to manage as well, because quite often the wine warms up as soon as decanted. And should you put it back in the fridge in your decanter for 1 or 2 hours, it's so difficult, you know, so difficult to manage.
So many.
But sure, one thing essential, and I say that for all the wine amateurs, more and more, I do not hesitate to put, if you have a temperature control cellar, that's of course the best, but do not hesitate to put your wine for 1 hour in the fridge. You know, you should drink wines at 66, between 66 and 68 max, you see. 65 will be fine. And it's almost impossible today because it's too warm and it's essential for all these wines which are above 14 today. So people ask for wines, I'm sorry, that's not part of the question. People ask for wines above, below 14. It's impossible today to produce wines below 14. Why? It's not only the global warming, but what most people don't know is the level of CO2 in the atmosphere. With so much CO2 today, and there is no way, apart from pandemias, I hope we don't have too many, where the CO2 level diminishes. With the CO2 level today, it's clear that the nature is more active. The plants are producing more sugar by themselves. And that we cannot diminish. Whatever is the canopy, whatever we try, we cannot diminish the alcohol today. That's a given. And the only way is to serve those wines a little cooler. That's the only way to appreciate them. I'm sorry to be a little heavy on that, but no, that's essential.
That is wonderfully described and explained. So thank you. That makes so much more sense. So let us taste the 2017. It does make sense. It does. So I want to taste the 17 with you. You talked about this being more difficult, challenging vintage and being more selective. And not taking in all the little details that okay. You don't want to do, but in broader spectrum or broader phrases.
I didn't speak of the color so far.
Yeah.
Do you see it like me? It's red. I would say it's dark red or intense red or bright. You know, one thing I hate in the world of wine are those what described as black wines, or inky is the worst for me. I mean, I never drank ink even when I was at school, you know. So I don't like inky wines. For me, it's kind of repulsive, you see. So I produce red wines, sometimes dark red, but they have to be red. That's the first quality of a red wine, is to be red. That's kind of obvious.
It's a good qualification. My red wine must be red, yeah.
So I find some, but it's getting warm. I apologize for that.
No.
I find some, just to be controversial, some blue fruit in that, you see, in between red and black. It has a nice aromatic palette. Not intense, but discreet, but it is there. Something which has always surprised me in Dominus is that the wines are soft, maybe because they are not acidified, as I said earlier. But there's a natural softness, which is very confusing because many people, you may have heard that, when I produce a wine which is 90% Cabernet Sauvignon, they think it tastes almost like a Merlot from Pomerol, you know. Mm-hmm. And it is very confusing and troubling intellectually for me, but that's the way it is. And there's a softness, an after length, you see. It's long, it's delicate, it's a well-balanced wine. Honestly, it has progressed so much since its bottling 1 year ago that I begin to be optimistic about the future of this wine.
It has beautiful structure, and Dominus is known as a magical wine when it comes to aging and longevity. Why do you think that is?
Oh, well, you are very flattering. I never dare to use magical for my wines, but I think because of what I said earlier, the fact that we use very little oxygen. So it means I think the wine could age almost forever. Speaking of a great vintage like 2013, I think it's a wine which will be great in 50 years or 100 years, because not only is very concentrate, but the structure. And this is what makes the difference, you know, the soft tannins. You can measure tannins, but between soft and hard tannins, there's a world of difference, which make either a pleasant wine to drink or something impossible, yeah. So that's the quality of the tannins, so essential.
Vintage is also important, so I want to talk a little bit about vintages, because I know a lot of people tuning in are either saving vintages or have some open now. So I wanted to touch on a couple because one of our guests I know has the first vintage of Dominus, the 1983. I mentioned that he's saving it for his 40th. You had mentioned you tasted that last year.
Yeah, I had it last year. We have very few bottles left. You know, when I launched the wine, it was in 87, if I remember correctly, it was a disaster. People say, oh, well, that guy who came from Pomerol, he does not understand a thing. That wine is undrinkable. Probably I made a few mistakes. So it would be technical. But in Pomerol, usually with our Merlots, which are so soft, we add a big part of the press wines to structure our Merlots. Of course, here, the Cabernets are naturally so structured that you don't need very much press wine. And in 83, I added all the press wine. So it's even a small thing. When we were ready to launch the 13, I mean, 1 month earlier, I tasted the wine and it was so tannic, so awkward, I dare to say, that I said, oh, no, I cannot put that on the market. And we launched the 84 instead of the 83. And the 83 we launched later, you know, I was so worried. And finally, years and years later, of course, those hard tannins have been integrated. And the wine is not perfectly balanced, but it's quite good today. So. Okay. Thank you for being patient.
And patience. And I just...
Something about the vintages, you know. When I arrived to Napa Valley, the view from Europe, at least, all those Napa Valley wines, they taste all the same. You know, we don't make difference because the climate is always the same and we don't make difference between the vintages. This is completely wrong. I will dare to say today, there's almost as much difference between vintages in Napa as there is in Bordeaux, especially in Bordeaux, now that with global warming, we make a good vintage almost every year, you know. So, it's very interesting. That makes the wines much more interesting than one would believe. The image of Napa was, as I said, standard quality. It's not. It goes up and down, which makes it interesting.
So thinking of some vintages that might be showing well now, I want to kind of touch on some of those, especially in the 90s. I'm just going to throw this out because I know I have a couple of friends having a viewing party with a 94 and a 96. How are those vintages showing? Those
The first great vintage of Dominus was probably 91, which had a high level of Cabernet Franc, unusual at the time, something like 17%. So the wine was very, very elegant, or is very, very elegant. Quite remarkable. 92 was good. 93 was a disaster, so I declassified the 93. And 94 was an abandoned vintage, which was obviously great from the very first day. I remember giving a tasting for the wine spec at San Francisco at the time in November 94. I said, you have produced the best vintage ever of Napa, quantity and quality. And that was it. As I said, we were vinifying at Rombauer at the time, and it was a little difficult in terms of sanitation. So 94 is a very good vintage, great potential. Some bottles sometimes are a little fragile, I would describe, but it's part of the game. Otherwise, when you have a good bottle, it's a very, very good wine. 95 was good. 96, I love 96 from the beginning. It was a little, it was supple, it was tender, I would say, if I can use that for a wine. And I still love the 96. Some people find it lacking a little structure, maybe, but the wine is charming, yeah. You know, from time
to time.
That's
the wine behind, I mean, my Dominus behind me is a 96.
Well, probably, I don't remember it was already at 14, probably not. So it's slightly lighter, but so elegant.
And what about the 2000? I know the 2006 was one of your favorites that you were...
Yeah, 2006, I had the bottle over the weekend. I mean, blind, I would have said a Mouton Rothschild of a good vintage, you know. I could not believe it had the structure, it had the brightness, that kind of, I will not say the cassis typical of Mouton, but it's a beautiful wine. Interestingly enough, when we launched the 06, people criticized. They say, oh, no, it's awkward. Because the last day before bottling, I thought the wine was a little fragile, maybe, like the 96. And I added two barrels of press wine. which I never do so late. And I was desperate after, because the wine was kind of awkward for a few years. Today, I don't regret my two barrels. It is structured, it's magnificent. I will not use magical, but magnificent.
I like magnificent. And I believe that wine.com might be getting some re-release
in 2006. Again, because the wine had no much success, we didn't put the whole quantity on the market at that time. So we have a Chateau Reserve, which we will be offering in the second part of the year, yes.
Okay, so stay tuned, everyone, for that 2006.
Awesome. So don't miss
it. Let's put 2006 in there. Do you have maybe three favorite vintages that you think would have either the most tender, which I love that word, or...
Yes. Well, I should say that we have got more refined, partly because our technical director, Todd Mostero, is so talented and so precise. Speaking of precision, Speaking of precision today, it almost looks very banal because everybody speaks of precision, but could you show the image of the vineyard again, that you showed those rows, you see?
Yes. I will tell producers on it.
Okay, so look at that.
Yeah.
When you speak of precision, that's precise, you know, and to have a vineyard manicured like a garden like that, that's precision. And it goes from control from A to Z. And believe me, that's a huge effort, almost impossible. You cannot be precise all along the way, you see. So thanks to Todd, we have got more precision in our wines. It's clear, in our grapes and in our wines, yes.
And so in the, I want to talk about Bordeaux also, just because that is your home. I know you manage several properties over there, or produce several properties and do a lot with hundreds more, bringing them into the country here. So the 2019 vintage, we usually have en premiere in April. Obviously this year it was a little bit of a different circumstance, if you will. Can you talk a little bit about?
Oh yeah, it's one of the strangest adventures of my life. I tell you why, as many people know. 19 was a very good vintage. The wines are beautiful almost everywhere. I will single out probably Pomerol and Pauillac, which is not original for maybe the best successes, but they are beautiful wines everywhere. But because the economical situation was difficult, tariffs and everything, you know, and of course China, we thought there would be no campaign. And many people, serious people, were ready to skip the campaign or to try it in the fall. Anyway, and all of a sudden, by mid-May, our friend Tesseron from Pontet-Canet decided to come out with his wine out of the blue, with lowering the price of by 31%. Wow. People could not believe, you see. And from there on, it has been a rush. Everybody lowered the price. And Bordeaux, all of a sudden, which has suffered the Bordeaux bashing for the past 10 years so severely, all of a sudden, Bordeaux was fashionable and people rush for that campaign. You have no idea. We buy as wine merchant about 70 chateaus from the right bank, and thanks to my son Edouard, with our sister company Auto Rivage, we buy 240 wines from the Médoc. You know, I have tested all of them, and I must say it's one of the great vintages of my long career at a reasonable price. So don't miss the wine. I mean, it's a sure bet.
Yeah. So we've been having wine.com has done very well. So this is what the Americans, we call it futures, that you call en première. So en première. And so yes, it's a, I think it's a great time to invest in some Bordeaux.
You should not miss it. I mean, because I don't know if Bordeaux will remain reasonable in the coming years. It will depend on many economical factors, but at long last, we are back to, we are affordable again.
Okay, yes. We can finally say it's a Bordeaux value.
Maybe it will be time for Napa to be affordable again. Yeah. But that's
true. Well, we just hope that Napa continues to make some of the most incredible wines, such as Dominus and Napanook, which are some absolute favorites, ones that we want to put down and keep, but also enjoy now. So Christian, I would just want to thank you for joining us and sharing.
I should be the one to thank you and your followers, because I understand why they follow you first. Fantastic. And wine.com is a fantastic company. I mean, it's so smart. It works so well. So I'm very proud to be part of that evening.
And merci beaucoup.
Avec plaisir.
Oh, merci. Au revoir.
It's both a science and a form of high art. It's made from the combination of grapes, sunlight, rain, soil, and time. It's raised up in the moments that matter. It's wine. And we are wine.com. We have the largest wine selection in the world, online sommeliers with free advice, and now our powerful new app puts the entire world of wine in your hands. Wine.com. Seriously passionate about wine. Download our free app today.